When you're learning medicine, there are two dominant ideas that you have to internalize. The first is that clinical medicine is built on a foundation of basic medical sciences. If you're learning a basic fact in histology or physiology, you've got to say, where do I use this in patient care? The second and harder idea is that every patient encounter starts with a chief complaint. Why are you here? And from that, you form a differential diagnosis. What are the most likely causes that I have to sort between? A common mistake students make when they're doing a chief complaint in a differential is that when they have the chief complaint, they don't reason through the possibilities, but instead get a shotgun and shoot 1,000 possible answers, hoping that one of them miraculously will be correct, and they will then be able to move on. When they read the question, they're hoping that the writer will give them a little buzzword, nudge, nudge, wink, wink, this is all you need. Well, they don't. Not only do they not do that, they consciously read their questions and purge anything out of it that you could possibly use that way. And that way they're measuring, can you think like a doctor? So when you're doing a patient encounter and you find the chief complaint, remember that the differential diagnosis, the possible causes of that chief complaint, are going to be built on a robust, tight understanding of pathophysiology, because you're going to look to that pathophysiology to reason through what's the most likely explanation of this patient. Once you can see that pathophysiology in your mind's eye and you can compare them through the story, you then have to say, I'm going to now weight these by risk factors, which we'll go into in another video, is a measure of prevalence. So pathophysiology and prevalence drive all the differential diagnosis and the reasoning through what is the most likely cause. And so that is a story. And every patient encounter, and therefore every history of present illness, and therefore every good clinical vignette, tells a story. If you're new here, we post a new video every week talking about how to learn medicine, not only because it's going to make you a better doctor, but frankly, because it's going to make it much easier to write your exam. Instead of taking first aid and brutally trying to force learn all those facts, you can take first aid and tell stories with all those facts, because that's what doctors do. So hit subscribe. I actually wrote down all the pathophys and much of the reasoning in my textbook. I think you'll find it really helps. It's very reassuring to be able to come back and read something. If I haven't taught something in a while, I come back and read it too. So click the link in the description. I'm Dr. Philip Tisdall. I come out of decades of clinical practice in small hospitals, running laboratories and doing pathology in the operating rooms. In my 50s, I discovered this deep love of teaching, and I've been doing it for well over a decade now. And in doing all that teaching, I've realized no one's making it easy for students to move from the basic sciences to clinical reasoning. And now you have to, because step one's a clinical exam. So what do we mean by chief complaint? The obvious and conventional answer is to say, that's what the patient comes in and complains of. That's not wrong, it's fine as far as it goes, but what it really is stating is, I want to find a term, an idea, that medicine agrees we have an approach to it. So the patient can come in saying, I have difficulty breathing. Medicine would say, shortness of breath / dyspnea, we all know how to approach that. A patient can come in and say, I have this crushing feeling in my chest. Medicine will talk about chest pain. We all have a standard approach to that. Patients come in and complain of indigestion. We will translate that into epigastric pain. Those are chief complaints, a point from which we have a standard approach. A good chief complaint gives you a good differential diagnosis. Now, when you see a very experienced clinician, they're going to take that differential diagnosis as diseases. That's not what we're going to do as medical students. Instead, as medical students, that chief complaint, which is our doorway into that differential diagnosis, is going to have a broader reasoning approach. It's going to go like this. If I have something like shortness of breath, we're going to instead say, what organ system could that be? And that will be heart or lung. From the organ, we say, which family of diseases is that? So for shortness of breath, that would be left ventricular congestive heart failure. But that's going to subdivide into other families because left ventricular congestive heart failure can be classified lots of different ways, and you kind of have to know them all. If you're doing it in an echo center, they will classify it by, is it a reduced or preserved ejection fraction? If you're doing it by likely causes, it's going to be ischemia, hypertension, and valves. But even if you get to valves, that's still a family with further subfamilies because your valves can be mitral or aortic. You're still not at a diagnosis because your valve can be regurgitation or stenosis. Once we get to a nice, discrete diagnosis, aortic stenosis, then we can invoke our knowledge, presentation pathophys natural history. And pathophys sits at the center. It is the foundation stone of everything that follows in presentation and natural history. So let's talk about what we mean by presentation, pathophysiology, and natural history. Medicine breaks into diagnosis and treatment. I mean, that's the universe of medicine. And when we say diagnosis, generally speaking in medicine, the term for that is presentation. And it consists of symptoms. What does my patient complain of? Signs. What does the doctor find on the physical exam? And then testing to test out and prove what you suspect from the history and physical. And testing is overwhelmingly going to be laboratory and imaging. When we say natural history, now as a student, you have to shift your brain. We know you haven't seen patients yet, but obviously the whole point of diagnosis is to talk to your patient. So once you have a diagnosis, you're going to say, Mrs. So-and-so, you have this diagnosis. And she's going to say back to you, what happens to me? And the term for that obviously is prognosis. And then your patient's going to say, do we have complications? And the answer is, we have to look for these complications. And then the third obvious one is there anything we can do about it? And that is treatment. Now, you notice I didn't say drugs. Treatment has a wide range of drugs, surgery, radiation, just watching it patiently. So treatment is a broader idea than saying, I'm going to do pharmacology. So we can say presentation, consisting of history, physical, and testing, and treatment, which we call natural history, prognosis, complications, and treatment, both sit absolutely on the foundation stone of pathophysiology. To master treatment and diagnosis, you have to master pathophysiology. You've got to have a tight, true understanding of the mechanism of that disease. So let's talk about this idea of pathophysiology. Pathophysiology is really different than talking about risk factors. When we talk about risk factors, actually, that kind of belongs over on the presentation side when we talk about epidemiology. To have a high blood cholesterol doesn't mean you're going to get atherosclerosis. It's only a risk factor. That's different than pathophysiology. Pathophysiology says when we start this pathology, what happens to that organ over time? So I can start with what's the pathophysiology of atherosclerosis, and in your brain, you've got to be able to say injury to the endothelium, fatty streak, plaque. And from that, I can drop into all of those for a deeper understanding. But that's a nice, tight understanding of atherosclerosis, isn't it? So when I say to you, discuss the risk factors, way over on the epidemiology side, you can say, anything that damages endothelium. Well, now you don't have to memorize a list. I bet cigarette smoke has toxins. I bet hypertension has barotrauma. I'll bet that when we talk about things like homocysteine, I don't know how it works, no one does, but I bet it damages the endothelium. That will always be a good bet because pathophysiology makes everything else work well. So every disease you do, make sure you've got the right understanding of that pathophysiology. Here's one students never get right. When I say cirrhosis, I only want two words from you. I want portal hypertension and I want elevated estrogen. That's it. If you have those two, everything else follows. And then you say, great, tell me about portal hypertension. I only want three words. I want portal systemic anastomoses. Yes, there are three. I want splenomegaly and I want ascites. So when you can do that, cirrhosis just trips off your brain and everything has to follow that pathophys. So a tight understanding of pathophys means all of your epidemiology, all of your symptoms, all of your what's going to happen to me, aren't things you memorize and go, that must be true, right? So today we're going to start this discussion of differential diagnosis. And you can't do a differential diagnosis if you don't have pathophysiology. And I've always believed it's really hard to have words. It really helps to have examples. So I actually teach the learning of medicine by teaching medicine. And that does two things. First of all, you learn how to learn. But second of all, and you end up with a nice little piece of medicine that's already in your bag. So it just works great. So I was thinking through what's a really good way to do that. And here's one that comes up all the time when I'm teaching, and students really struggle with it. So let's use that. And it's the chief complaint of edema, you know, where the skin swells and you can put your big fat thumb and it leaves a dent that will slowly fill in. So how do you think about edema? And you'll always get these scattered answers. People shout it out just like they always do. And the answer is you don't need to do that. You just need to have Starling's forces. So you do your little picture of the vessel and you have hydrostatic out and oncotic in. And when we say, okay, translate that in disease, you go, yep, there's two out. Right ventricular congestive heart failure and chronic renal failure. Okay, give me the two for lack of oncotic pressure in. Well, it's 80% albumin. So if you know that fact, you go, well, I bet it must be diseases that don't have albumin. The answer is, yep, it's as simple as that. You're going to have cirrhosis. Liver makes all the albumin and a big chunk of it goes into the ascites. Got it. And the second is you can pee it out in nephrotic syndrome. So when I say edema, I'm expecting in your brain, you've popped up a blood vessel, you've got hydrostatic out, oncotic in, and two diseases for each. I can do that, and I can remember it forever. So that gets us started in the family of diseases. Now I can take each of those entities, I'm going to say, tell me the pathophys of them. Well, we did cirrhosis, right? I only want two words, portal hypertension, elevated estrogen. When I say right ventricular heart failure, you're going to say, got it. It's just the right ventricle backing up. So right ventricle, right atrium, up into the superior vena cava, gives me my JVD, and down so I swell the liver and I swell the legs. And voila, there's my edema. I have a nice, tight picture that will explain everything you need to know about that disease. Nephrotic syndrome, I pee out the albumin. Well, I guess I have damage in the glomerulus. I guess you do. And there's lots of causes of that, but we're right in the right place, aren't we? And then when we say, tell me about renal failure, well, yeah, you lose the capacity to regulate sodium and water. You become hypervolemic, and now we've increased hydrostatic pressure. Is there a whole chapter discussing chronic renal failure? Of course there is, but that sure works well for the edema part, doesn't it? So, chief complaint edema, pathophys, Starling's forces, hydrostatic, oncotic, two for each. What now happens when we're looking at the clinical vignette? If you're writing up your patient, is the same as if you're doing a multiple choice question. You're looking for something in the pathophysiology that says, I've got to be in right ventricle. I've got to be in liver. And there's two ways of doing that. One is, what is the pathophysiologic mechanism? And then later we'll discuss, and what are the risk factors? But let's just start with the pathophys mechanism. So supposing I have edema, and I get to add one more fact. What if I told you they had jugular venous distension? Well, let's go through the list. Does cirrhosis have that? Nope. Does nephrotic syndrome have that? Nope. Does chronic renal failure have that? Nope. So if you're reading in a vignette with edema and you've got JVD, it's got to be right ventricular heart failure. You're not memorizing a fact. You've got this picture of right failure backing up ventricle, atrium, up superior, down inferior. I could tell you, what if I had a palpable liver edge that was a little bit tender? Well, you know you're in right ventricular failure because none of the others do that. So when you're doing a history and a physical and testing, you're looking through each of those pathophyses, and now all of a sudden you realize what we're talking about. Now you're not shooting blind and hoping that God blesses you. Now these are directed questions. I'm looking for the symptoms of right ventricular heart failure. Commonest cause is left ventricular heart failure. So you're going to ask, what's the symptom for that? Is shortness of breath. So if I've got edema and a patient that has shortness of breath, I've got left and right ventricular signs. I know I'm in heart. You can't do that if you don't have these pathophys pictures. You're just memorizing facts and they slip away. If I tell you I've got edema and you tell me the patient has ascites, I know I'm in liver with cirrhosis. I'm not in heart. So you can't do a differential if you don't have these key fundamental ideas of pathophys. So you always, when you start a disease system, you always want to say, Do I have a really good mental picture of the pathophys? And then I don't have to memorize any facts. I just have that picture with the story. So you can't do a differential diagnosis without pathophys. You come and take a look at what the name of the book is. It's pathophys. That's not an accident. If you can do pathophysiology, presentation and natural history follow naturally, and you've done 70% of what you're going to need going into clinical medicine and your exams. So if you really want to master this, that's why we wrote the book Clinical Pathophysiology. You can listen to me, you can get the book, and you can study it for yourself. It's written so that you can learn this on your own using this resource. So if you want to continue this discussion, our previous lecture was Clinical Medicine is Built on a Foundation of Basic Medical Sciences, and you can see that video here. Next week, we're going to continue this discussion of differential diagnosis, except now we're going into this idea of how do risk factors drive prevalence, and now not the mechanism of disease, but the likelihood of disease. Hope you'll join me.